Hello, you malty mojo masters, and thank you to the Malt Bar for that malt mention, introducing, as it does, Whisky Review 462 here at Ralphie.com, one of your little stopping places for malt moments, whisky information, and other assorted spirity stuff here on this virtual cyberspace that is the internet. The great thing about this virtual experience that we're sharing is that it may be virtual in the middle, but where I'm recording and where you're watching is definitely in real space and time. So is this malt whisky. It's in a real space and time of its own. Aberlour A'bunadh. This is batch 48 and it's bottled at 59.7%. So pretty strong cask strength stuff. Matured exclusively in ex Oloroso sherry butts. It is small batch stuff. And interestingly, I have reviewed this before not just once, but twice. So in fact, this is a re-review. This is the third review of the same brand of whisky. You will find the first review in whisky review number 3. So one of the very earliest whiskies that I reviewed was this Aberlour A'bunadh, because I was such a fan of it in the early days, because it was a real good bang for your buck single malt whisky, and very tasty with it. And in whisky review number 3, it was batch number 24, and I gave this 91 points out of 100. Now, that was 5 years ago. But last year, in whisky review 356, I reviewed batch number 42 and gave it 89 points out of 100. Now, this is batch number 48, so we're a few batches on. Malt mark, we'll have to wait and see. I shall give you some smell notes, taste notes, give a wee resume, and then a malt mark. What's interesting for you is that this is the first whisky that I've reviewed more than twice. Now, I don't happen to have any plans to do that for many whiskies, but I think this is quite useful for yourselves, because if you're interested to look back to the previous reviews, you start to see a timeline developing on a specific whisky brand, which perhaps in its own way will be useful for you. Oh, there's a sharpness in the nose. It's quite red fruit, boiled red fruit sweets, strawberry, raspberry, blackberry, kind of mixed dark fruits, dried fruit, raisin sultana. Certainly a pungent sherry note, but quite a dark toffee-ish sherry, as if the sherry has been basically baked in the oven almost. This is, the richness is there. I can refer to that from experience. It's the same as it was in previous batches, but there's a certain youthfulness. And I am taking into account that over time, my tastes change because of the developing experience of sipping and smelling and tasting whiskey. And it happens to yourself as well. Even if you're not consuming a lot of whiskey, over time your own perceptions and judgments and appraisals will change as you gain experience. But I can take that into account here. There's a certain acidity on the nose, a sharpness which is beyond the fact that I'm sniffing high alcohol strength whiskey. It does settle down, but you will notice it particularly when you open the bottle for the first time. I am, of course, going to add water now. I've added approximately 25% water there, 2 teaspoons to what is roughly a 25 milliliter serving. Just roll this gently about in the glass, let it settle down now. Again, that resinous, sharp, almost slightly mentholy, minty, red fruit intensity, still very much intact. The sultana element and the sherry element has subsided with the water content, but not that sharpish, slightly solventy note. It's settling down gradually, and it's basically, if you imagine you're in a sweetie shop at the boiled fruit counter, as if they have a, you know, I know sweetie shops don't have boiled fruit counters, but if you imagine your reference should be like slightly throat pastel, throat lozenge, hard sugar sweets, brightly coloured ones, Fox's Glacier fruits, if you can make that reference, Pascal fruits, if you can make that reference as well. You will if you're in Britain. It is settling down now, but that sharpness, that a slightly acidic, vinegary, sharp note is still there. And a wee taste. Big sherry monster arrival. As soon as the arrival part is over, the development starts to fade slightly. Then steadily, the dried fruits are there, cinnamon, clove, toffee, dark honey, what you would expect from an Oloroso sherry matured Speyside whisky, which is what Aberlour is. The finish is remarkably light, far lighter than I've noticed in previous bottlings. And bear in mind, malt mates, I know this whisky well. There's a nuttiness coming in. That's lovely, a Brazil nut note coming with the toffee. The development's starting to extend a little bit now. But then it kind of hits this slightly solventy, mentholated naphthalene as well. Slightly ashy, burnt caramel finish. I'm going to add just a drop more water. I mean, as you can see, I've been tasting this whiskey steadily. With the strength of it, naturally, you don't pour very much. So I reckon I've had about 7 or 8 while I've really sort of saying, well, let's not go in first impressions. It's always risky. Let's give it time. Let's give it the benefit of a doubt. Let's come back to it tomorrow and the day after. So we'll taste it a few times before we actually settle down in front of the camera in the Manx Bothian to record the review. And the nose is very pleasant. The nose is holding its own. The flavour of the development, the arrival, but in the development, it's missing a component. It's missing the richness of the sultana of the dried fruit. And because that richness is missing, so is the spice element. So you have something that's a little, definitely tastes younger, slightly undermatured. And in the finish in particular, the finish just fades. It literally evaporates even as it's happening. I could say there's a little bit of vanilla in the finish and honey, but it doesn't really hang around long enough for anything substantial. So I'm getting a very strong reading here from my own experience that the casks being used for the maturation of A'bunadh are certainly not the same casks or same calibre of casks as previously. And also, the maturation is not, I'm getting a strong impression that the maturation is not happening for quite as long as it used to be. Now, it could be that it's simply you've got reconstituted casks here, which is where sherry butts are shipped in flat pack, or whether they're used and then before they're refilled and used again, having already contained single malt whiskey, they're charred and flamed to activate, reinvigorate the wood. And the risk is that if it's done too much, you get this slight chemical note, carbony note, and you simply don't get the fullness of flavour that you get from a fresher cask. Now, I have to quantify this, malt mates, by saying I'm giving you a personal opinion here, and I'm always wary of approaching distillers for information because it may be accurate, it may be right, but at the same time, you may get information that is not particularly useful or is inadvertently misleading. That can happen. So to kind of keep it as practical as possible for the benefits of a review, I don't phone distillers or email distillers for information. It's best that I simply take whatever I'm reviewing at face value as I find it, because that gives me the most consistency in reviews. Malt marks. Right, we're looking at, there we go, 84 out of 100, it's a malt mark. So I can't hide the fact it's compared to even batch 42. This is a different Abernathy, in my opinion. It's just simply not so fully matured. And it's certainly nothing, and I do mean that in the fullest sense, like the earliest batches of Aberlour A'bunadh, which were magnificent, great quality, value for money, go to, grab it while you can, single malts. And perhaps that is why we're seeing early versions, batches 14 was fantastic. That's why we're seeing them appear in auction now, whiskey auctions, and people are bypassing contemporary bottles to go to auction and buy old bottles, simply because they're looking for the quality that they remember first time round. Now, there's a challenge here for the producers, and it's something that I was going to discuss in Whiskey Review 461 when I re-reviewed Highland Park 12-year-old, but I slightly got sidetracked. I know you're patient, you understand. I'm not editing, I'm not scripting, I'm just sitting here and chatting solidly for the full duration of the Whiskey Review. That's the way I do it, because it keeps it nice and simple and practical and a little bit fresh. But I did omit to say that what I'm noticing with the re-reviews of whiskies that I'm coming back to, and to be honest, I'm dreading even buying a bottle of Lefroy Quarter Cask, because I'm almost sensing I'm going to be disappointed. To be honest, that's what I'm noticing. I'm looking for likes of Lefroy now. I'm looking to the independent bottlers more methodically, more systematically, to provide me with a genuine, full, you know, satisfying experience of Lefroy. And I make no bones about it. It's just the way it is. I don't rely on samples. I buy the bottles with the advertising revenue, etc., etc. It's the way I do it. But I've been kind of thinking about when I'm re-reviewing, and I'm noticing that I'm saying casks are not what they used to be. And by that, what I mean is that distillers are generally better at looking after the consistency of their new-made spirit production. It's more methodically controlled, and all the staff operating in the distillery are by and large, sober these days. Wasn't always the case. As we look back with rose-tinted glasses to yesteryear and some of the malt disasters that got bottled due to inebriated production and people in production. But there's the one component, the one element that makes a malt that I feel that distillers right across the board have to pay even more attention to than they already do, and that is the calibre of casks, because there is a noticeable difference between a whisky matured in a fresh cask, in other words, a cask that's just, where's my little cask? Where have I put it? There it is. If a cask arrives in Scotland complete, intact, as is, with previous content, dregs and trimmings sloshing about inside, that is going to mature new make spirit very differently, not just a bit differently, very differently from a cask which is reassembled from staves which are not necessarily the same staves altogether from when the cask was first made. And here's a problem for the distillers, is that discerning malt fans are noticing it. Now, in the old days, it didn't really matter because people bought whisky books and read magazines. The internet didn't exist, but now the internet does. And pesky little malt anoraks like myself and some other commentators are highlighting at this. And we're doing it for a very simple reason, because we care about the long-term future of whisky, not just the short-term profits. And goodness knows the whisky industry is making huge profits now, proportionally to production, particularly in single malts. Such is the demand, such is the fashion that we're experiencing at the moment here in 2012. But it's a challenge for distillers. They're making big profits, they're regenerating casks because they can't get enough casks, but still we're noticing that in the finish of a whisky in particular, it's falling short. The quality's no longer there. We have points of reference because of whisky auctions. We have points of reference because we're discussing it. And then you guys are leaving comments. And by the way, the whisky industry follow your comments as much as they follow my videos. That's the way it works. They're looking after business. They want to know what the buzz is online. And one of the buzzes is that we recognise, as today's whisky drinkers, the more discerning and fussy we are as customers, the more we contribute to a future legacy of quality whisky for the next generation that come after us. We can't leave it all to the industry. There's guys in the industry care so much about what they're doing. And it's a difficult job. It's a challenging job. But they need our help. So that rather than being passive consumers, you know, as the marketing would like us to be in many instances, we are proactive customers. And that is a big, big difference. We don't just lift a glass of whiskey and say, it's smooth, that's nice, that's lovely, end of story. Good luck to the folk who enjoy the whiskey that way. I'm not trying to be elitist or too critical here. I'm just being practical and observing the way it is. But for the discerning customer, being careful about how we spend our money, being careful to look after the value of the return of our euro, pound or dollar, that's important. And a suggestion I'd like to make to the whisky industry, the whisky producers, in terms of upping their game with casks is simple. Now, I've talked about inner staves. Inner staves have been used in the whisky industry. They were mentioned as part of promotion by Compass Box Whisky when they produced a bottle called Spice Tree. It was very tasty. I tried it. I enjoyed it so much, I bought a bottle. And then it was banned. It was banned because the Scotch Whisky Association says inner staves inside a cask of whisky are not traditional and cannot be used. Despite the fact that I have sat in pubs with retired coopers who have spent a lifetime's career refurbishing barrels, building barrels from scratch, servicing casks. They've done all that. And they have used inner staves. They told me so. The wine industry and across Europe have been using inner staves successfully for generations for the simple reason it works. So if you're in the Scotch whisky industry and your casks are getting flagged up for being a little bit below par because they're reconstructed and they're rejigged, re-engineered for maturing whisky, well, a very cost-effective, value for money, cheap system that actually works is the use of an inner stave like this, toasted, good quality Lamaison, inside the cask, just like we see here against this stave. That's the way it sits. That's an inner stave. It works treats. It would lift the quality of whisky. So I would suggest perhaps some folk in the whisky industry should contact the Scotch Whisky Association, suggest very nicely, and for the best of intentions, why don't you undo that decision and let's concentrate in improving the quality of our casks by whatever method actually works. And this works very well. And we know it works because the wine producers know it works. And if you ever get to taste a bottle, a sample of Spice Tree from Compass Box, first edition, mind, it's got to be the first edition, you will see for yourself how well an inner stave can work. And here it is. Does that look expensive? No, of course not. It isn't. Anyway, I think that's really covered what I intended to discuss in my previous whisky review but didn't. I hope you'll join me shortly. I'll be reviewing another whisky. It won't be a re-review or a re-review. And it will be a whisky I haven't reviewed before. A single malt, yep, from an island, yep, but no more spoilers. I hope you'll join me for that in Whisky Review 463. It'll be along in a couple of days. You don't have to wait that long for it, but in between times, just reassure me, please, that you will drink moderately, drink sensibly, keep it quality, and whatever you learn about whisky, from whatever source you learn about it, always be generous in sharing your experience, your recommendations, and what you consider to be good whisky or any other good spirits with people who are perhaps less informed or less experienced by yourself, because the most valuable education anybody can have is the education we create for ourselves through the experience of life. There we are. Did that sound philosophical? Of course it did, because it was. We'll see you soon.